Forwardness and Consolidation, Sunnyside, Currumbong, New South Wales, May 31, 1896. Elder O.A. Olson, Battle Creek, Michigan. My dear brother, scenes that were ashamed to Christians have been presented to me as taking place in the council meetings held after the Minneapolis meeting. The loud voice of dispute, the hot spirit, the harsh words resemble a political meeting more than a place where Christians were met for prayer and counsel. These meetings should have been dismissed as an insult to heaven. The Lord was not revered as an honored guest by those assembled in council, and how could they expect divine light to shine upon them? How could they feel that the presence of Jesus was molding and fashioning their plans? The place of meeting was not held as sacred, but was looked upon as a common business place. Then how could those assembled receive an inspiration which would lead them to enthrone truth in their hearts, to speak words in the tender, loving spirit of the Master? In your council meetings and committee meetings, decisions are made, plans devised and matured, which, when put into practice, leave an impression on the work at large, and no vestige of a spirit of harshness should appear. Loud, impatient words should never be heard. Remember that in all your council meetings there is a heavenly watcher. Do not allow one word of vanity to be spoken, for you are legislating for God, and he says to you, be still and know that I am God. If your committee meetings and council meetings are not under the direct supervision of the Spirit of God, your conclusions will be earthborn and worthy of no more consideration than are any man's expressions. Christ says, without me ye can do nothing. If he is not honored in your assemblances as chief counselor, your planning comes from no higher source than the human mind. Brother Olson, you speak of my return to America. For 3 years I stood in Battle Creek as a witness for the truth. Those who then refused to receive the testimony given me by God for them and rejected the evidences attending these testimonies would not be benefited should I return. I shall write to you, but should I return to Battle Creek and bear my testimony to those who love not the truth, the ever-ready words would rise from unbelieving hearts. Somebody has told her. Even now, unbelief is expressed by the words. Who has written these things to Sister White? But I know of no one who know them as they are, and no one could write that which he does not suppose has an existence. Someone has told me, he who does not falsify, misjudge, or exaggerate any case. While at Minneapolis, he bade me follow him from room to room that I might hear what was spoken in the bedchamber. The enemy had things very much his own way. I heard no word of prayer, but I heard my name mentioned in a slurring, criticizing way. I shall never, I think, be called to stand under the direction of the Holy Spirit as I stood at Minneapolis. The presence of Jesus was with me. All assembled in that meeting had an opportunity to place themselves on the side of truth by receiving the Holy Spirit, which was sent by God in such a rich current of love and mercy. But in the rooms occupied by some of our people, we heard ridicule, criticism, jeering, laughter. The manifestations of the Holy Spirit were attributed to fanaticism. Who searched the Holy Scriptures as did the noble Bereans to see if the things they heard were so? Who prayed for divine guidance? The scenes which took place at this meeting made the God of heaven ashamed to call those who took part in them his brethren. All this the heavenly watcher noticed, and it is written in the book of God's remembrance. The Lord will blot out the transgression of those who since that time have repented with sincere repentance, but every time the same Spirit awakens in the soul, the deeds done on that occasion are endorsed, and the doers of them are made responsible to God and must answer for them at his judgment throne. The same Spirit that actuated the rejectors of Christ rankles in their hearts, and had they lived in the days of Christ, they would have acted toward him in a manner similar to that of the godless and unbelieving Jews. God's servants have no tame testimony to bear at this time, whether men will hear or whether they will forbear. He who rejects the light and evidence God has been liberally bestowing upon us rejects Christ, and for him there is no other Savior. The work at Battle Creek. The Spirit of the Lord has outlined the condition of things at the Review and Herald office. Speaking through Isaiah, God says, I will not contend forever. Either will I be always wroth, for the spirit should fail before me in the souls which I have made. For the iniquity of his covetousness was I wroth and smote him. I hid me and was wroth, and he went on frowardly in the way of his heart. This is precisely what has been done in the office of publication at Battle Creek. Covetousness has been woven into nearly all the business transactions of the institution and has been practiced by individuals. This influence has spread like the leprosy until it has tainted and corrupted the whole. As the publishing house has become corrupted, the General Conference Association has stepped in and proposed to take the diseased child off its hands and care for it. But it is a snare for the General Conference Association to take the publishing work on its shoulders. This puts no special sanctity upon the work, but upon the General Conference Association a burden which will weigh it down, cripple it, and weaken its efficiency, unless men who have firm principle mingled with love shall conduct the business lines. In this step there has been a change of responsibility, but the wrong principles remain unchanged. The same course that has been done in the past will be carried forward under the guise of the General Conference Association. The sacred character of this association is fast disappearing. What will then be respected as pure, holy, and undefiled? Will there be any voice that God's people can regard as the voice they can respect? There certainly is nothing now that bears the divine credentials. Sacred things are mixed and mingled with earthly business that has no connection with God. To a large degree, the General Conference Association has lost its sacred character because some connected with it have not changed their sentiments in any particular since a conference held at Minneapolis. Some in responsible positions go forwardly in the way of their own hearts. Some who came from South Africa and from other places to receive an education which would qualify them for the work have imbibed this spirit, carried it with them to their homes, and their work has not borne the right kind of fruit. The opinions of men which were received by them still cleave to them like leprosy, and it is a very solemn question whether the souls who became imbued with a spiritual leprosy in Battle Creek will ever be able to distinguish the impressions received in Battle Creek that have done much to retard the work in South Africa. As things now exist in Battle Creek, the work of God cannot be carried forward on a correct basis. How long will these things be? When will the perceptions of men be made clear and sharp by the ministration of the Holy Spirit? Some there do not detect the injurious effects of the plans which for years have been working in an underhanded manner. Some of the managers at the present time are working in an underhanded manner. Some of the managers at the present time are walking in the light they have received and are doing the best they can. But their fellow workers are making things so oppressive for them that they can do but little. The enslaving of the souls of men by their fellow men is deepening the darkness which already envelops them. Who can now feel sure that they are safe in respecting the voice of the General Conference Association? If the people in our churches understood the management of the men who walk in the light of the sparks of their own kindling, would they respect their decisions? I answer, no, not for a moment. I have been shown that the people at large do not know that the heart of the work is being diseased and corrupted at Battle Creek. Many of the people are in a lethargic, listless, apathetic condition and assent to plans which they do not understand. Where is the voice? From whence will it come? To whom the people may listen, knowing that it comes from the true shepherd? I am called upon by the Spirit of God to present these things before you. And they are correct to the life according to the practice of the past few years. Consolidation of the publishing work. The Lord has presented before me matters that cause me to tremble for the institutions at Battle Creek. He has laid these things before me, and I shall not be consistent if I do not seek to repress the spirit in Battle Creek, which reaches out for more power, when for years there have not been men who are qualified to preside with Christian truthfulness over the charge they already have. The scheme for consolidation is detrimental to the cause of present truth. Battle Creek has all the power she should have. Some in that place have advanced selfish plans, and is any branch of the work promised a measure of success, they have not exercised the spirit which lets well enough alone, but have made an effort to attach these interests to the great whole. They have striven to embrace altogether too much, and yet they were eager to get more. When they can show that they have made these plans under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, then confidence in them may be restored. 20 years ago, I was surprised at the cautions and warnings given me in reference to the publishing house on the Pacific coast, that it was ever to remain independent of all other institutions, that it was to be controlled by no other institution, but was to do the Lord's work under His guidance and protection. The Lord says, "All ye are brethren," and the Pacific Press is not to be envied and looked upon with jealousy and suspicion by the stronger publishing house at Battle Creek. It must maintain its own individuality and be strictly guarded from any corruption. It must not be merged into any other institution. The hand of power and control at Battle Creek must not reach across the continent to manage it. At a later date, just prior to my husband's death, the minds of some were agitated in regard to placing these institutions under one presiding power. Again, the Holy Spirit brought to my mind what has been stated to me by the Lord. I told my husband to say in answer to this proposition that the Lord had not planned any such action. He who knows the end from the beginning understands the matter better than erring man. At a still later date, the situation of the publishing house at Oakland was again presented to me. I was shown that a work was to be done by this institution which would be to the glory of God if the workers should keep His honor ever in view, but that an error was being committed by taking in a class of work which had a tendency to corrupt the institution. I was also shown that it must stand in its own independence, working out God's plan under the control of none other but God. The Lord presented before me that branches of this work would be planted in other places and carried on under the supervision of the Pacific Press, but that if this proved a success, jealousy, evil surmisings, and covetousness would arise. Efforts would be made to change the order of things and embrace the work among other interests at Battle Creek. Men are very zealous to change the order of things, but the Lord forbids such a consolidation. Every branch should be allowed to live and do its own work. Mistakes will occur in every institution, but if the managers will learn the lessons all must learn to move guardedly, these errors will not be repeated and God will preside over the work. Every worker in our institutions needs to make the Word of God his rule of action. Then the blessing of God will rest on him. He cannot with safety dispense with the truth of God as his guide and monitor. If man can take one breath without being dependent upon God, then he must lay aside God's pure holy word as guidebook. The truth must take control of the conscience and the understanding in all the work that is done. The Holy Spirit must preside over thought and word and deed. It is to direct in all temporal and spiritual actions. It is well-pleasing to God that we have praise and prayer and religious services, but Bible religion must be brought into all we do and give sanctity to each daily duty. The Lord's will must become man's will in everything. The Holy One of Israel has given rules of guidance to all, and these rules of guidance are to be strictly followed, for they form the standard of character. No one can swerve from the first principles of righteousness without sinning. But our religion is misinterpreted and despised by unbelievers because so many who profess to hold the truth do not practice His principles in dealing with their fellow men. To my brethren at Battle Creek, I would say, you are not in any condition to consolidate. This means nothing less than placing upon the institutions at Battle Creek the management of all the work far and near. God's work cannot be carried forward successfully by men who, by their resistance to light, have placed themselves where nothing will influence them to repent or change their course of action. There are men connected with the work at Battle Creek whose hearts are not sanctified and controlled by God. If those connected with the work of God will not hear His voice and do His will, they should be separated entirely from the work. God does not need the influence of such men. I speak plainly, for it is time that things were called by their right name. Those who love and fear God with all their hearts are the only men that God can trust. But those who have separated their souls from God should themselves be separated from the work of God, which is so solemn and so important. E.G. White.